Hello, welcome to the interview here on France 24. Well, a former U.S. ambassador to Baku, the capital of Azerbaijan, once described the Caucasus nation as a, and this is a quote, a very small country on a very significant piece of real estate. Now, few would disagree. It might lack access to any ocean, but Azerbaijan is perched on the Caspian Sea. That's a source of tremendous oil wealth that has lured Western investors and also made the country a pivotal conduit for energy supplies to Europe. Now, lucky geography has also made Azerbaijan a transit point for U.S. troops and equipment en route to Afghanistan, and it's boosted Azerbaijan's status as a strategic U.S. ally. But there's a flip side of this success story, and critics say it's a regime that's also engaged in corruption, sometimes even election rigging, and that there have been efforts to clamp down on the political opposition. Now, there's also the so-called frozen conflict with Nagorno-Karabakh. That's a predominantly Armenian enclave within Azerbaijan over which a bloody war was fought 20 years ago and where peace, even today, remains elusive. Now, my guest here in the studios is Azerbaijan's foreign minister, Elmar Mamardariev. Thank you very much for being here. You're laughing because I probably still got your name wrong. We practiced before going on air. Welcome to the show. You recently said, in a speech you gave, that you see Azerbaijan as having the potential to be a bridge builder in the region, as being a peace promoter. Yet at home, you've been unable still to resolve this Nagorno-Karabakh conflict 19 years after the peace treaty, ceasefire was signed in 1994. Why? Why can't you get this conflict resolved?
That's true. Unfortunately, not everything depends on Azerbaijan. Yes, you're absolutely right that Azerbaijan is trying to build up its foreign policy, building up a good neighborhood with all of our neighbors. And so to some extent, we succeeded in this policy, because if you look on the map which you show, you find out that we have our neighbors, the Russian, Iranians, Georgia, Turks, and the other countries on the other side of the Caspian Sea, and with whom we managed to build a very good, friendly, strategically important, mutually respected cooperation and relations. The only missing puzzle is Armenia.
And it's a big missing link, isn't
it? It's a big missing link, which we are very much eager that we should find out the way how we have to deal with the conflict resolution, at least to end around 20% of occupation of our territories.
Sir, I don't want to get into the actual statistics. I know the 20% figure is often cited. Some people, as you know, dispute that. What is clear, and correct me if I'm wrong, is Azerbaijan does not recognize Nagorno-Karabakh in any independent status. You consider it occupied territory.
Yes, no one is recognize it as an independent entity, including Armenia themselves. Plus, of course, if we take into consideration that the major body for the international relations is the United Nations Security Council, you can find out that in 1993, UN Security Council adopted 4 resolutions with regard to the conflict and the basis for the resolution of this conflict. And it's all 4 resolutions is clearly indicated that Karabakh is part of Azerbaijan, territorial integrity, sovereignty and inadmissibility of internationally recognized borders. So within this, what we're trying to reach is that at least the most hectic and the most problematic issue for the conflict resolution, the presence of Armenian troops on the soil of Azerbaijan with notorious ethnic cleansing of all occupied territories.
Ethnic cleansing, obviously, we're once again getting to difficult territory there. That's a very charged term when you're using that term. I want to ask you, though, the reality is this is a predominantly Armenian territory right now. What can you do? You can't just kick them all out. They consider it their home.
That's exactly what we're saying, that we consider the people of Armenian region who are living in Nagorno-Karabakh, who are still there, as the citizens of Azerbaijan, with all appropriate approach to them. And despite that, even if we were trying to explain to Armenians that they were trying to use the international principle of self-determination, we're saying just yes, but it doesn't mean that you violently can interrupt the principle of territorial integrity. Besides that, in Nagorno-Karabakh, there was a population of around 25% or almost 40,000. who used to be of Azerbaijani region. And these people should return
back. And
this
is the question of what we call internally displaced persons.
Absolutely.
And refugees. Meanwhile, the reality is we do have, for better or worse, a new generation growing up, kids in their teens or 20s, who are looking at Azerbaijanis, looking across trenches and barbed wire at Azeris. There's hatred already in their hearts.
Besides that, this is one of the issues which is always playing a very important role psychologically. But on the other hand, you see, just a few probably knows that it's not only Nagorno-Karabakh itself, but it's also seven adjacent territories beyond of Nagorno-Karabakh administrative borders, where never ever even single Armenian used to live, which totally now under occupation.
Which you consider, you say they occupied it.
It's totally,
those regions.
It's, of course, there's no doubts of that, but it's including the position of the international community of that. But what we're suggesting is let's address this issue step by step. Let's clean the table of negotiations from the issues which can hamper the peace and stability in the region, which means that if the Armenians will agree to withdraw their troops from surrounding areas, that will allow us not only open communications, return of IDPs, peacekeeping monitors, security, addressing of security concerns, and reduce the tension, including what you mentioned about the trenches, but as well as we can finally come to the idea of the defining of the legal
the
status
defining.
Of NK.
We have seen, especially just looking at Syria right now, what can happen when a relatively small country with some very powerful friends and neighbors erupts in conflict. Do you fear sometimes that at any given moment, if you don't resolve this,
that's
a war
very
can
good
break
question
out?
Because one of the issue which we definitely face radicalization of the situation. I don't want to make a comparison to any other conflict because each conflict got its own history and roots. But one of the things that if there will injustice will go on, of course radicalization will go on because you correctly indicated about the people's mind, the young generation. And who didn't see the war, and so on and so far. And then you see the development is going on. We'll probably move to other side because Azerbaijan is very dramatically, if I may use this word, develop itself according to the economic performance. Yeah. And then it comes that the people will be sitting one day and say just why we should sit down and wait for this humiliation when humiliation that's reduced, let's ourselves solve this issue
Let me change track a little bit, talking about development. You were one of the fastest growing economies in the world just a few years ago. You used to supply half the world's oil in the early 20th century. Azerbaijan is famous for its oil wealth. And you have a big pipeline that now runs from Azerbaijan via Georgia to a port on the Turkish, a Turkish port, Eastern Mediterranean. You have tons of oil. Some people would say despite all that oil wealth, average Azerbaijanis are not seeing it. They're not benefiting from it.
Which is a little bit overplayed. I believe that the average of Azerbaijan is those who are traveling and visiting Azerbaijan can find out that there is a tremendous changes. Tremendous changes in the landscape, not only Baku as a capital, but as well as the regions are rebuilding. A huge investments going into the different infrastructural projects. Only one single I can mention about constructing of the railroad, Baku-Tbilisi-Kars, connecting the railroad network between Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Turkey, which will allow, for example, those who are living on the other side of the Caspian Sea and beyond of that, like in China and so on, using the railroad connection to Europe up to it will be a connecting missing link between the railroads connection. And besides that, everything has happened because this is the investments which we can allow to make because of
is
the
is there a fund? How does it work? Some of these are million and millions of dollars.
We establish a special sovereign fund which calls oil fund. We use the pattern and experience of Norwegian oil fund, how to spend it. And it's very transparent. It's on annual basis. It's audited by the Ernst & Young or the other big audit companies. And it's open. You can find out the information about the activity of the fund in internet and email. So sometimes it's easy to blame, but if you look inside and make Googling Azerbaijan, you can find out that it's not so bad as some...
Google Azerbaijan. Let's talk politics in the little time we have left. You're shaking your head a little bit.
No, it's okay. I'm all yours. Look, I'm all yours.
Critics of Azerbaijan, and there are some very vocal critics, I don't need to tell you that, say that this is a regime of massive corruption that's been ruled by one man who's now seeking a third term, President Ilham Aliyev. And that there have been arrests of opposition figures. There's been a crackdown on opposition. And he looks like he's set to win this third term.
You know, it depends. First of all, what I would think, it's democracy building for us. It's not to please someone. It's what we have to do ourselves. And it's for the national interest of my country, which was definitely numerous time announced by my president. It depends how you address and by whom you're addressing the issue. Because I don't believe in conspiracy theory, but unfortunately, in some cases, I can find out that somebody behind the ugly story of non-existence in case of Azerbaijan. And whenever you say it's a process, it's a generational process, what we have to build up. In case of democracy, there's no angels in the world, and you have to admit that.
But let me ask you, but why is, stupid question maybe, why is Aliyev seeking a third term? I mean, you know, he's been in power since...
And why he should not seeking for the third term?
Because didn't he have the constitution changed or whatever
It was done a few years ago. I believe that it was done correctly from my point of view, that if you're building up the country, and you need, and we are in still country in transition with all the risks and challenges which should be faced by any country in transition. And if you just promote through the last 10 years a stability in the country, which allow not only economic performance, but as well as building up the whole social...
Stability, I would perhaps suggest also some people say fresh blood at a certain point is needed. I want to note for our viewers, I'll give you the last word on this briefly. President Aliyev recently signed a law making it a crime to post defamatory and offensive views on the internet, punishable by up to 3 years in prison. That was a law. That's on the books.
But it's not only in our case, by the way. Some other countries did it the same. But on the other hand, because we are not
What's
only
he scared
doing
of? What's he scared of? He's been in power.
But it's not a scary one, because we have probably the most open internet and social media in the entire region, including the all post-Soviet countries. And this is, if you look inside that, having the free media. And then you can use it for anything what you want accordingly.
Well,
it's probably the response to what you said.
We're going to have to unfortunately leave it there. We could go on. I know it's been very politics, oil, and Nagorno-Karabakh, yeah. All at 11 minutes, 30 seconds. You heard it here on the interview on France 24. My guest today has been the foreign minister, Elmar Mamadyarov. Thank you very much for joining us and speaking briefly about some of the big issues in your country.
Thank you very much for having me here.
Thanks to all of you for watching the interview.